So, good evening. This is the last presentation. So, I just want to start with two disclaimers. One is that I know nothing about snakes and South Sudan, and I've never been to South Sudan. My only knowledge about snake bites was the last week, where I was briefed through Skype with a team that did this fantastic study, and I read some literature. The second disclaimer is that I would like to share with you that when, as member of the scientific committee, we decided to accept this presentation for several reasons. One is that this is actually neglected. We realize that this is a neglected condition. Second, this study, as you will see, is very well done, is well methodologically well done. And third, the findings are striking. And four, it coincides with a global adivenom crisis that is happening this time. So I can only share with you some excitement of discovering a new field, and I hope that I will do justice to the people who did the study. So our colleagues are in this little town in the north of South Sudan called Dagok. And they run a hospital of almost 200 beds, and they do almost everything from emergencies to maternal health. And they have a lot of snake bites, snake victims. And one of these victims is this little cute fella who was bitten by a snake on his face. So the team there decided to study this the snake bites in their area. And they actually realized that this is a worldwide neglected condition with quite a significant burden, but also quite underestimated. I mean, if you see the numbers of bites, 5.5 million, 1 million envenomed, and the deaths vary between 94 to 150,000. Just to give you a little bit of data about India that I discovered recently, the estimates were something between 1,500 deaths due to snake bites to 50,000. And there was a survey done which called 1 million deaths, and the one part looked also at snake bite deaths, and they found approximately 46,000. So actually it was closer to the higher estimate. So back to Sudan, our colleagues there, they had in month of May 2014, 90 cases, so three snake bites a day, and they had three deaths in 2014. So this, I think, kind of triggered this study. And this is what I said about a methodologically well-done study. I'm surprised as an epidemiologist that they used three sources of data. So one was the hospital registers. Some teams will just stop there, will not go further, even we know that hospital data usually don't give a lot of information. They did one survey using a kind of a snowballing thing. They found some high figures, 409 bites. They thought that maybe something was wrong with their survey, so they did another one with randomly selected, more well done. So actually they have three sources of information. And what is surprising is that what made them, and this is a picture from a survey in the field, so what actually they thought that it was too high, what was the survey number one, with an incidence of 1688 per 100,000 bites, 1,688 bites per 100,000 population per year. Actually, it was an underestimate, because the second survey were more well done, showed much higher at 3596 per 100,000. This is extremely high numbers, I mean, 100,000 per year, extremely high numbers of snake bites, and a quite high case fatality ratio. The first survey 4.4, and the second survey 2.3%. And they looked also at the distribution, the demographics of the snake bite victims, and you can see here that they looked at the gender and age groups. There's a bit of discrepancy between the three sources of data. The hospital data shows more male victims, while the community surveys show more female victims. I think this is an interesting finding. Maybe the team wants to explore more. There was not much difference between the age distribution. I will skip this table because it's actually identical to this one, and this shows pictures of seven species of snakes. To be honest, I only know the cobra, because it looks like the cartoons of the snake charmers also in India. But I have to tell you that there is, for the ones who find this fascinating, and actually it's quite useful, not just fascinating, there is a database. And there is an Indian database, which I think, and I am sure that there are some other South Asian. The Indian one is www.indiansnakes.org. It's very easy to remember. And I will ask you to consult it. It's interesting. So, describing the epidemic in time and place, location of snake bites, 37% in the house. I think this is very interesting. Activity, while most of the people were out in the bush, 20% of the people who were bitten were while they were sleeping. I think this is quite scary. Biting sites, mostly the legs, but as you saw from the previous picture, any part of the body can be bitten. This little fellow was bitten on his face. And timing of the bites, evening and late night, up to midnight. Apparently the snakes are. Looking at seasonality, if you see these are the three graphs from the three different sources of data. Similar pattern, small differences. I don't think I want to go through this, but again, this what it shows here is that you have a season in India and in Southeast Asia is the monsoon season. I guess this is also the rainy season in Sudan, where most of the snakes are at their nastiest when they go out and they. And looking at the clinical now characteristics of the people who get envenomed. First of all, 65% almost of the people who were bitten by snakes had an envenoming syndrome. And the three most common syndromes are the cytotoxic one, which is like swelling and up to necrosis of the area, of the affected area. You have hemototoxic syndrome, where you have clotting disorders. That's like the blood clotting disorders, and neurotoxic syndrome. And there are some other syndromes like cardiotoxic and etc. But I think these are the three most common. And according to the literature, this is not only in Sudan or in India or in Southeast Asia, it happens worldwide. In this particular study, they found that 55% of the patients had cytotoxic, 26% hemotoxic, and 4% almost neurotoxic syndrome. These are some pictures just to show that how it looks when you have some of these syndromes, and also this little bottle there, it's just a simple test to see clotting, and it doesn't require sophisticated machinery or devices, just a bottle and some time waiting to see. So our team there has this syndromic approach, and they have this nice algorithm. I don't know if it's really visible just there, but actually what it shows that based on the history of snake bite, you look at different syndromes, what I described before, cytotoxic, neurotoxic, hemotoxic, and then you, based on that, you can see what are the snakes and what are the snakes most likely. And if you add this algorithm, this is the Adivinum algorithm, where based on the snakes or based on the syndrome, you can administer the appropriate one. To be honest, for me, that I don't know so much snakes, I say, why we don't have a polyvalent Adivinum that we can give with no-brainers? Why we need algorithms? We just have to have a bottle and just give it to everybody who has a syndrome, whatever is the syndrome, whatever is the snake bite, etc. I guess these are also our colleagues from Sudan are more affected than me asking this silly question. Then, looking at risk factors for death. I think if you see this analysis shows that age was children and adolescents 0 to 15 were the most affected. Syndrome, the progressive cytotoxic symptom has the odds to die from after a snake bite was almost 31. And if you haven't, I think this is important, if you haven't been given an Adivinum, your odds of death were 25. I think this is quite high. It shows the confidence intervals are quite wide, but it's because the number of deaths it's quite small in this analysis. A difference between access to Adivinums in this particular setting, and you see that in the health facility it was 27% that people that got the Adivinum, while in MSF hospital it was 81. And also, if you see the last line there, I think it's interesting to mention about the communities that traditional practices still were used, and 67% of them got about this thing that it's kind of tradition in many cultures and communities, cut and suck, incision and suction. 46 were using a black stone to treat snake bites and tourniquets. A very nice mapping. I think this could help also to identify some interventions. If there are some, you just plot the snake bites, the locations of snake bites in a GPS system. This, I don't think you can see, the green are the snake bites, and the red points there are the snake bites deaths. So, this was the first snake bite survey in South Sudan. I think it was the team has to be commended for this great job that they done there. They have some limitations. Maybe snakes were misclassified, and maybe they have, since they ask the people, recall bias is always a problem with this kind of surveys. However, they found quite high in incidence compared to African literature, and a very high community case fatality ratio in the community, 2.3 to 4.4%. You notice the large variety, at least seven pictures there, large variety of snakes species, which actually highlights what I said, why we don't have a polyvalent antivenom, instead of having several little bottles and trying to find which one is to use. Highly seasonal monsoon period and the high odds of death if you have not given, if you were not given the antivenom. And this is the conclusion. That this study reports maybe the highest documented incidence of snake bites, a very high mortality among patients who don't get treatment. They used a quite nice study methodology using three sources of data, and they addressed a quite neglected tropical disease issue in a neglected area. So the team there, and I think most of us will call, will echo their call, ask for positioning of the antivenoms to the places that are needed. It's like finding the hot spots where the snake bites happen and make sure that the antivenom is there, not in state capitals or in the country capitals or in hospitals, tertiary hospitals, and make sure that you train the communities and the staff how to handle the snake bites. And just to finish with this antivenom, I said there is a global crisis right now. I think I was briefed that just this month, next month, the last batch produced by a company is about to expire. There is no new production. There are several companies who produce antivenom, including some Indian manufacturers. However, there is no much published data on their efficacy and safety. And I hope that I did, at least I didn't share knowledge, but I hope I shared the enthusiasm, excitement that this was a very good study, and I'm very happy that I was given the opportunity to present it on their behalf. Thank you very much.